Creative Brain Candy, by creators for creators.
Antonia.
She isn't real either, is she? Nothing here is. Nothing here matters. You know, maybe this isn't about an empty house. Maybe it's about that empty chair on the bridge of the Enterprise. Ever since I left Starfleet, I haven't made a difference. Captain of the Enterprise.
That's right.
Close to retirement?
I'm not planning on it.
Let me tell you something. Don't. Don't let them promote you. Don't let them transfer you. Don't let them do anything that takes you off the bridge of that ship, because while you're there, you can make a difference.
Come back with me. Help me stop Solon. Make a difference again.
Who am I to argue with the captain of the Enterprise? What's the name of that planet? Viridian 3?
Yes.
I take it the odds are against us and the situation is grim.
You could say that.
You know, if Spock were here, he'd say that I was an irrational, illogical human being for taking on a mission like that. Sounds like fun.
Everyone, and welcome to Smoking and Drinking in Space. This is a sci-fi podcast from a couple guys who think they know sci-fi. And this week we review the movie that brings TNG to the big screen, drops the Roman numerals from the title, and bridges the old with the new. It's 1994's Star Trek Generations. But first, he's the overly emotional android to my under-emotional Frenchie. It's James. How are you doing, James?
Frenchie? With an English accent?
Yes. Well, you know, as only... Sir Patrick Stewart can deliver.
Yeah, no, for sure. Watching this made me long for the days when it didn't sound like he had smoked 17 fucking cartons of Marlboro Reds before he walked on set.
And he's the head of engineering that never goes to engineering. It's Rob. How are you doing, Rob?
Where is engineering?
Yeah, it's a lot like real life. Like, where's IT and yeah.
What does IT stand for?
You're right. It's magnets. How do they work?
Pencils. How do they work?
Jeez. Oh, my God. You two are dumb.
James, what's happening around CBC?
Lots of stuff going on this week around Creative Brain Candy Media Cooperative. First and foremost, I'll go ahead and pimp myself because that's what I fucking do here. Cigars and Coffee, Episode 3, Drive-Thru Coffee and Cuban Cigars is out with myself and Tim. So check that out over on the Simply Stogies YouTube channel, or you can probably go to creativebraincandy.com and click the link there. I think there's a link. Yeah, there is. I'm looking at it right now. Also, episode 35 of Simply Stogies podcast came out. Project E Granola review from Epic Cigars. I give you my thoughts on that cigar as well as tell you why it's important. We came out with a statement of ethics and what that's all about. Catobophobia, episode 13, Building Routines and Fighting Authority is out. The boys talk about, guess what? Building routines and fighting authority because fuck the man. Episode 114 of Bad Gamers Anonymous, Mild Stomping Grounds. They did Ghost of Tsushima or Tsushima, depending on which voice actor decided to read the line the wrong way. And I'm not sure who did what, but I did host the show this week. Go check that out. Ice Forward March will have a new episode coming out, so check that out with Sergeant Seagar, I think is what they go by over there. I'm not really 100% sure, but that sounds about right. And last, and certainly not least, the girls over at STD out every Thursday, FYI. They're talking about the Bedroom Strangler. Don't threaten me with a good time.
Wait, what's the Bedroom Strangler's name?
Russell Johnson, I think. I don't know, but hey, I don't know. Like, what's a bedroom strangler?
That's when you don't use your safe word.
Right. Like, look, if you're gagged, you've got to have like a tap out thing.
Yeah.
Right. And if you're bound, you got to snap. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not hard, guys. Figure this out. Come on.
You know a lot about safe words and safe motions.
Well, you Jason, know, he does like to pimp himself out, apparently.
What I know about safe words, passwords, and other things that go on in the bedroom could fill a fucking encyclopedia.
How many pages? Two?
Well, it depends on how big the encyclopedia is.
Front and back?
That's
what we're asking here. How big would that encyclopedia be? I mean, how much knowledge do you have? Is it like a page and a half double-spaced or?
Cornucopia of knowledge.
26-point font?
Okay, so it's about corn. Gotcha. So it's probably volumes. Well,
naturally.
There you go. Also, while you're out there screwing around on the fucking internet, looking up safe words, passwords, and whatever else I was fucking talking about, cornucopias, make sure you check out the latest and first episode of Creative Brain Candy's Brainstorm. That's out there on the YouTube channel. Or you can go to creativebraincandy.com. Check that out. There will be a new episode next Saturday, or this upcoming Saturday, I guess I should say, depending on, you know, where you're at in the space-time continuum. So check that out. If you are a creator and you want to join this media co-op, which raises the tides of all the ships in the sea except this one, because Status is indeed a shit show.
It's the anchor that holds them all in place.
Fucking A. That is about right.
We don't want them to drift too far.
creativebraincandy.com. Click the apply button and we too can show you how to not get good. Well, we will. We'll help you out. I've been podcasting for 10 years. Like, we'll help you. I'm joking. But Status is a shit show.
Wow. All right, Rob, you got some news for us this week.
I do.
This is good news for everybody except Jason. They have announced the release date for Star Trek Discovery Season 3. That is going to be on October 15th. So right Yay. After Lower Decks finishes. It starts up basically the next week. Yay, congratulations. Woo! Mark your calendar. Except Jason.
Yeah, I'll be skipping that. What else you got?
Okay.
Wait. Why do you insist on skipping Star Trek?
I don't insist on skipping Star Trek. I insist because on that'll skipping be the fall. Discovery.
That'll be the fall. That's not the summer Star Trek. That's the fall of communism.
What?
Well, Black Widow comes out in the fall. You got to go watch
it
that.
I guess
Russian.
It could be the FOSS, the fall of shit shows. I don't know.
Ooh. So you're going to watch 11/22/63 multiple times and
listen to Status
and Metropolis 2?
Electric Boogaloo, yeah.
Yeah, there you go. Electric
Boogaloo.
What else All you right. got?
Well, apparently there is some research out there and a little bit of a study. This guy put some stuff together based off of three different studies and has come up with what is going to save us from space radiation when we go to Mars.
Oh, I think I saw this.
Yeah, it's going to be the Chernobyl fungus.
Yeah. Yep.
Yep. Yep. Fungus from specifically Chernobyl. Apparently, huh? Yeah. Huh. Apparently, one of the like rust and melanin is real good at being radiation shields. And they looked at specifically some fungus that was from Chernobyl that they took up into space, and it was able to produce compounds and things like that. And looks like it might be viable for blocking radiation. So we're going to block ourselves from the space radiation and irradiate ourselves with some Chernobyl sunscreen.
I think they can probably block the radiation coming from the fungus if the radiation is being blocked by the fungus from cosmic rays.
Yeah, whatever. We're just changing one radiation for the other. And we are going to be going to Mars in a shit tube.
A shit or, tube?
Yeah, shit sure. Tube? Shit tube, maybe a mushroom. We're just going to be a giant fungus.
Yeah, that's right. They're gonna just grow a giant mushroom, and that's how we'll get. Yeah, that's how that works.
I envision the workers when they go to build this spaceship, they're just gonna like put their hand into a vat of fungus and just start smearing it on the walls like bus stop bathrooms are with shit, right? You know this, don't you, Jason?
Wow. You went to a really dark place, Rob.
I did, didn't I? I'm sorry.
Like a really weird place? I'm not, like, what bus stop bathrooms are you going to that have fucking shit smeared on the walls? This is gross. I can't even believe
only the good ones that keep you inoculated from coronavirus.
So I don't know about bus stops and bus stop bathrooms, but bus station bathrooms are typically pretty clean. I mean, I only frequent the cleanest of bus stations because I prefer a higher class clientele.
Gotcha. Yeah. Okay. Okay. My bad. I tell you what, let's rewind and let's bring it on back and talk a little bit about some time travel.
Oh, good God.
Yes, sir. So according to an article that I found, no, not really. Crowley found it, gave it to me, which I'm not sure why he's perpetuating my time travel fetish, but whatever.
Well, I'm just glad you finally admitted it's a fucking fetish.
Oh, it is. It's like you and feet.
I'm not sure why.
Well, you're you and safe words. Yeah.
Right.
Your
when you're in the bedroom with your wife, do you make a role play that you're that like you went back in time or you're from the future? Or?
Yeah. She goes, "Hey, Mr. Spaceman. Time traveling spaceman, who are you? Take me back."
Jesus Christ.
Anyway, so some people in Los Alamos, they used a quantum computer to simulate time travel, and they demonstrated the fact that in the quantum realm, there is no butterfly effect. You basically, things that you do in the quantum realm don't necessarily ripple out, which is like, to me, no shit, Sherlock. I've seen Ant-Man and Ant-Man 2. I know that quantum realm doesn't get affected.
I think it's a little different from Ant-Man and the Wasp. So time is different when you get down to the quantum level.
Yes. Yeah. You can live forever in there. Just ask, Janet Van Dyne.
She had Michelle aged Pfeiffer a little bit too while she was down there.
Yeah, so. But she still looked good. You could also ask baby Ant-Man because, you know, he did get changed into a baby. So he went back in time to when he was a baby and then peed himself. I've seen the movies.
Are you done with the news? Do you have anything else?
No, I got one more. Oh, I did that one because Crowley wanted me to.
Yeah, but I didn't want you to do it like that. I wanted you to actually talk about it, and instead you went to the MCU. No, it's fine. Do whatever you want to do. It's your segment. I don't give a shit. I gave you gold, and you somehow turned it into podcast fucking aluminum. I don't even know how you did this.
He's an alchemist. Very carefully, and I am.
You're the opposite of the golden goose.
I'm you a wizard,
give this
Harry.
Guy gold, and all of a sudden, like, gold's worth nothing.
Yeah, well, I'm glad you brought up the MCU because it has been officially announced that Haley Steinfeld is going to play Kate Bishop in Hawkeye.
Kate Bishop.
Yeah, apparently.
Who is that?
She is a character that takes over the mantle of Hawkeye from Hawkeye in the comics. She was the third person to take on the title of Hawkeye after Barton. And then Wyatt McDonald. I don't even know who Wyatt McDonald is. But anyway, she is a skilled archer and a martial artist, and it has been confirmed that she will be in the Disney Plus show Hawkeye, even after they like denied it way back in September last year.
They're giving Hawkeye a fucking Disney Plus show?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
They announced that way back in September.
Yeah. That's part of the phase four.
Yeah. Look. Do you either of you two still have Disney Plus?
Yeah.
Yes.
I've got it. Yeah, I signed up for 3 years.
Yeah, I did too, because you got the best deal if you signed up for 3 years. I'm going to be honest.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was dumb. Like I literally watched The Mandalorian on it, and that's it.
Well, you're going to watch The Mandalorian again here shortly.
Well, I know it's coming out again, but you know what? I could just do with this what I did with CBS All Access, which is just buy it when I need it.
I will say there hasn't been a lot of utility with Disney Plus, although I've used it a lot more than that. So we're going through all the MCU movies again, and that's really convenient that it's on Disney Plus, except for the fucking Spider-Man movies, which pisses me off.
Well, that's because those are Sony properties.
Right. But still, I mean, they could throw it up on Disney Plus. Come on. Because Disney was involved. I know it has to do with licensing and distribution rights and blah, 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 blah. But it's still fucking pain in the ass whenever I'm trying to go through all the MCU movies in a row. I get to a Spider-Man movie and then I got to change platforms.
So are you going through the movies in chronological order or in the order that they were released?
Release order.
Okay. I think I don't want to go down this road, but I'm going to because I'm just so disappointed with the gold nugget that I gave Rob and he turned it into a pile of shit. That's the wrong way to watch the MCU.
Why?
Because it doesn't make sense. You should watch it in chronological order and then it all makes so much more sense.
It makes sense the way it is anyway. I'm not going to fucking try and map out all of the goddamn movies.
You don't have to try. It's on the internet, ready to go. Here, let me do some research on the fly and help you.
Yeah, don't. I don't care. Don't give a shit. I'm not going to do it. So just stop.
Dude, I put the proper way to watch and it says MCU.
That's Rob logic right there. The proper way to watch and then it replies all the MCU. Marvel. Yeah.
Yeah, all the Marvel movies. All right, so the first one you want to start with is Captain America, the First Avenger, okay? Because that takes place during World War II.
Yeah, correct. I know.
Okay, the second one you want to watch is Captain Marvel.
Moving on.
That takes place in 1995.
Oh, my God. Who's ready for a pod crawl?
The third one.
You've kind of been Iron up for Rob. You do a pod crawl before I just keep dunking on Rob.
All right, let's do this.
We can call it, I don't know, say a pod crawl. The pod crawl. Pod crawl. Pod crawl. Pod crawl. Excellent. Insert it deep. Pod crawl. Kind of like a space suppository full of information.
A shiny bottle of Dom Perignon 22, 65 tumbles through space until it crashes against the side of the newly built Enterprise B. This will mark the spot where a giant hole will appear shortly. It's a media frenzy as Captain Cameron takes the ship out of space dock on a quick run around the block. Aboard for this momentous occasion are Captains Kirk, Chekhov, and Scott. But it wouldn't be an Enterprise maiden voyage if disaster didn't strike, and the ship wasn't ready to deal with it. There are two ships in the vicinity that are being ripped apart by a gravitational something or other, and as always, the Enterprise is the only ship that can save them. Captain Cameron orders the Enterprise to assist, but half of the ship isn't being delivered by Amazon until Tuesday, so their options are limited. Realizing his way over his head, he gives control to Kirk, who immediately puts the brand new ride into harm's way. They have no photon torpedoes, so they simulate one with the deflector dish, which Kirk has to go down and reprogram with a bunch of punch cards like an old mainframe computer. They manage to beam aboard about a third of the passengers on one of the endangered ships, and then punch their way out of the space wave, but not before the space wave punches a hole in the Enterprise, sucking Kirk out to his death. Fast forward to the 24th century, where the next-gen crew are cosplaying as late 18th century naval officers. Worf is getting a promotion, and will soon be going to a special kind of purgatory called Deep Space Nine. To prove he's worthy of being a lieutenant commander, he has to jump for his hat, or get wet trying in what is the tamest hazing ritual known to the history of the universe. Picard gets a message from home that shakes him to his core, and he's in a dark mood as they get a distress signal from a research post nearby. He delegates to Riker, who obviously doesn't want the job, and then retires to his ready room. Romulans have ransacked the research station looking for trilithium, a mystical form of lithium that is even more mystical than dilithium. One of the survivors, Dr. Soren, is eager to get back to his research, but Picard isn't allowing anyone back to the research station until the investigation is complete. Data, who has recently installed his emotion chip and is now fully bipolar, is assisting Geordi in the mystery of the Romulan attack when Soren shows up and incapacitates LaForge. Data, experiencing fear for the first time, is frozen in place as Soren fires a trilithium probe at the local star and causes its collapse and subsequent shockwave. Riker and Worf head over to save the day, but Soren is beamed aboard a cloaked bird of prey with Geordi in tow. The Enterprise falls out of the system just as everything is being obliterated by the shockwave. While trying to locate where Soren might have gone, Picard joins Data in stellar cartography to figure out what Soren was trying to do. When Data gets mopey for not helping his friend, Picard tells him to suck it up and do his job. They determine that the space wave is being redirected to the Viridian system, and that Soren wants to propose to it on Viridian 3. When the Enterprise D arrives, the Klingon ship uncloaks and proposes a prisoner exchange, Picard for Geordi. Picard agrees, but only if they will beam him down to the planet so he can talk some sense into Soren. After LaForge is cleared for duty and cleans up, he returns to engineering. The Klingons implanted a GoPro in his visor, though, so they can see everything he does. As he does his rounds in engineering, he reveals the Enterprise's shield frequency, which the Klingons then use to start throwing torpedoes that burn right through the shields. Data does some more punch card reprogramming and forces the Bird of Prey to cloak, which drops their shield and Riker shoots the Bird of Prey in the face with a torpedo. The Big E is heavily damaged, though, and Deanna is driving, so it crashes into the planet. Picard, meanwhile, is crawling through rocks and getting his ass handed to him by Soren. The probe launches, the sun collapses, the ribbon swallows Picard and Soren, and the system is destroyed. The end. But wait, there's more. Picard is enjoying a Dickens Christmas with his non-existent family. He's thrilled until he gets a visit from the ghost of TNG past. She tells him it's not real, and that Kirk is also having too much fun, so he should get him to help stop Soren. Picard finds Kirk at his cabin in the mountains, turns on buzzkill mode, and they both head back to the past to stop Doc Brown from destroying the solar system. Kirk takes the fighting duties since Picard has already had his ass handed to him once, and Picard goes to stop the probe. But Soren cloaks the probe launcher, since that's a thing, and Kirk sacrifices himself to recover the remote from the bottom of the couch and save the solar system. Picard piles rocks on Kirk's corpse, Riker helps him find his family album amongst the wreckage of the Enterprise, Data finds Spot who doesn't seem to be happy to be found, and roll everyone getting rescued by the Farragut, which will be destroyed in a few years, credits.
Spot got fat. Just spoiler. Like, I don't know what fucking nutrition regimen Data put that cat on, but Jesus Christ, that cat was a fat fuck by the end of that movie.
Well, I mean, what was that cat that shilled that cat food? Whiskas. I think it was Whiskas. Didn't Whiskas have that kind of...
That was lasagna, asshole.
Oh, my bad.
Garfield. Never mind. Fuck you, Rob. I hate you so much.
Yep. No, the fourth movie you want to watch is Iron Man
God
2.
God damn it. Shut the fuck up. Can I mute his track? I'm muting his track.
Yeah.
Kick him from Discord. God.
Just you and I today.
So podcast this was filmed in 1994, correct?
Filmed in 93.
Okay, so
No. I think it was filmed in 94 because they filmed it like 6 months or so before they released it. Because they filmed it right after TNG, the series wrapped.
Like they were ramping up for the movie while they were winding down TNG.
Yeah. In fact, they filmed the Enterprise B stuff while they were wrapping up TNG.
Yeah, because they didn't need the
didn't need the TNG crew there.
Right. So, okay, so 1994. We've been to space with the space shuttle, right?
A couple of times.
By that time, right? Yeah. We know how liquid works in space.
Mm-hmm.
So why did that champagne bottle explode and look like, you know, it splashed everywhere instead of globbing up?
CGI in space. I don't know. Because they didn't want to pay for Terminator effects.
Yeah. Okay. I don't know. I don't know.
Like, is that really, like, that's the, your number one takeaway from this movie is
no, that's just the first. No, that's just the first one.
I'm curious. I'm curious to know if that bottle would actually hold up in a vacuum, because I mean those contents are under pressure.
It's
champagne bottles.
It's space champagne.
Well, I know, but champagne. It's Dom Perignon, and
from 22 something or
2265. It was in the pod crawl. There you go. Did you not hear the pod crawl? Were you?
No, I mute the pod crawl.
he was researching MCU movies.
Oh, I was. The fifth one you want to watch is The Incredible Hulk.
Shut the fuck up. No, champagne bottles have a thicker glass on them to contain the pressure from the carbonation of the wine, but
now I want you to shut the fuck up. Let's stop talking about the goddamn
I'm
champagne.
I'm just curious
bottle.
To know if it would actually hold up in a vacuum, if the pressure from, you know, Earth's atmosphere helps keep that bottle intact. Moving on.
I don't care. Nobody cares. Nobody gives a shit about the fucking champagne bottle except you two clowns. Like, I don't know. Like, that's like, I get that it was like the first 10 minutes of the movie, and if you were stoned, it felt like it was a half an hour long watching this fucking champagne bottle just turn in space. Like, I didn't care. I didn't give a fuck. Fun fact, though, I did have a Captain Kirk Star Trek Generations action figure that came with a champagne bottle.
Nice. So yeah. A champagne bottle will not explode in space.
And he was in a spacesuit because the original, when they filmed it, there's a deleted scene where he's in a spacesuit and he throws the bottle and then they beam him back in and he takes the thing off.
Oh, okay. So he was the one that threw it. I didn't know he was who indeed. Threw it. I was wondering. Yeah.
I figured they just shot it out of the torpedo tube.
It's not the Search for Spock or fucking Wrath of Khan or whatever the fuck.
Well, they did that a lot, so I figured
there's always a goddamn photon torpedoes unless they weren't delivered by Amazon by Tuesday.
Right. Right. There's photon torpedoes and they always do some sort of surgery with plug and play objects.
Here's what I want to know is where was TMZ during the first six movies?
That's a good question. There's no
TMZ, but this fucking movie, goddamn, TMZ is right there to watch fucking Kirk fucking say engage.
Kirk was about to steal him another ship.
He was.
Yeah, he was. Yeah.
He tried.
He was ready to take on that captain's chair. But he decided, no, I'll go down and save the ship. I have never liked that aspect about TNG where they're flipping all those isolinear chips everywhere to reprogram shit. That is the dumbest fucking like way to program something.
Punch card programming.
Never understood that. I know it's visual. And it shows well on the screen, but it just makes absolutely no fucking sense. And does Star Trek just hate George Takei?
Yes. No, but George Takei hates Star Trek. He hates he hates Shatner that much that he won't show up for a fucking movie. Same with the rest of them. At that point, I think the feud was on pretty much with everybody, but they got Chekhov and they got Scotty Doohan to fucking suck it up and show up.
Well, they originally wanted DeForest Kelly and Leonard Nimoy, but DeForest Kelly was in pretty poor health at this point and he couldn't get insurance to be on the set. And Leonard Nimoy read the script and passed because he said there's nothing in it that's special to Spock. Anybody could say these lines and it wouldn't change the movie in any way. And so they gave those lines to Scotty and proved him right.
Yeah, but see, if Spock was on the movie would have been over after the first 10, 15 minutes because Spock would have been able to save both ships.
That's a good point. Like, that's why they needed Scotty and not Spock, because Spock would have figured it the fuck out, and Scotty's the one who's going to fuck it up, and now that's why Kirk had to quote-unquote die.
But the reason that Takei didn't come on board was because they wanted him to be the helmsman.
He was a captain already.
Yeah, he was a captain already, but they wanted him to be the helmsman that took the Enterprise out. And he didn't think that his character would have taken a demotion to do that. So, I mean, would they write his character to do that?
So they go, screw you. We're going to have your non-existent daughter.
Yeah, we're just going to give you this.
Yeah, you have a
family.
Daughter now. Yeah.
I didn't understand that. I know they wanted to have a Sulu at the helm to take the Enterprise out. There's been a Sulu at the helm for, you know, 30 years now on the Enterprise, pretty much, except for the last movie. But it didn't sit well with me.
Well, okay, so I don't know when the last movie ended, but it sounded like there was a few more years involved of Enterprise. So there was quite a few years of no Sulu at the helm.
No. While the last movie was their last mission. They were about to mothball the Enterprise.
Were they?
Yes. Yep. Which doesn't make sense either, because they just built that fucking ship. It was only 6 years old. Why build a ship and then fucking retire it after 6 years?
Because they wanted to have a new ship.
I guess so. And I've never liked the design of the Excelsior class.
Dude, it looks like a throwback to Spock's robe, you know, with the tubes in the center.
Yeah, it's,
you know, it's got that ridge. It's like they went, hey, let's go get a vacuum tube.
Oh, you know,
or
what?
A dryer vent.
So you talked about ridge. That reminded me. You said the word ridge. I want to talk about the ridges of the Klingons, because I'm going to be 100% honest here. The next generation version of Klingons is the best version of Klingons ever. It's better than Discovery.
I agree with that.
It's better than the original series. And it's better than the first six movies, which are very similar, but there's a little bit of difference. I honestly think the aesthetics of that Klingon are better. It's not just me being nostalgic. It's me taking an objective look at the new Klingons, the old Klingons, and the old Klingons, and going, yeah, this one's just better.
Oh, I can't stand the new Klingons.
Oh, my God. They're just, no. Stupid. They look dumb. I can't say the word that I want to use to describe what they look like, but that's what they look like.
Are they left-handed?
Yes. Yes, indeed they are.
Perfect. All right. Word has been described.
No, I agree. I don't like the new Klingons at all. And you can see some similarities between the movie Klingons, especially in Star Trek VI, but there was a reason for that. And the next generation Klingons, though the background movie Klingons are much more similar to the next generation Klingons. So in the last movie, Christopher Plummer asked that his Klingon makeup be less or more subtle so that he could, you know, express through facial expressions, and he didn't want the Klingon hair. And so that was his actor's.
So that's why he got the little ponytail thing.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's the difference there. But yeah, I agree. The next generation Klingons are probably the best version of the Klingons.
I'm glad you agree. And I didn't have to go on a rant to try to change your mind.
No, that's good. So why is Starfleet? And you brought this up in the pod crawl. Why is Starfleet so inept about building ships? That they insist on taking them out before anything is installed.
Well, I'm going to guess has something to do with TMZ. That's my guess, is that they needed Kirk. They wanted Kirk. This was the day they could get Kirk.
Yeah.
I mean, but it didn't sound like he had anything going on. Like, so he probably just lied to him being Kirk. Yeah. He's like, I'm busy on Tuesday.
Andorian, can we push it 3 days?
And then Dorian and an Orion hooker coming over on Wednesday, so can we push it to the week before? They're like, yeah, that's fine.
Yeah, that's yeah.
Well, and why don't they have any other fucking ships around Earth at any fucking time? It always seems like the Enterprise is the only fucking ship around Earth at that time.
Well, no, there's other ships, but they're in less states of repair.
Well, yeah. In the next generation,
because in that universe,
it makes more sense, right? Because the fleet was wiped out by Wolf 359 or at Wolf 359 the Borg.
That happened later on in the next generation series.
Well, that's what I'm saying. TNG, in the next generation, it makes sense. But it doesn't.
Well, no. Yes, it does. Yes, it does. For some strange reason, every time Scotty is in Space Dock, none of the starships work.
He took all the D batteries out.
Yes. He goes around and he's like, I'm just here to look around. And he steals all the D batteries out of every ship.
So Scotty's fucking sabotaging Starfleet.
He wants to be felt useful.
Well, that's probably true, because when he ended up in the Dyson sphere in fucking Next Generation, he was less than useful. So I could see Scotty doing that, fucking sabotaging other ships so that he's like, Scotty, we don't know what's wrong with this ship either. I'll be right there. And he's like, pulls out the D batteries and pops them in. Hey, there you go, laddie. I'm a miracle worker.
I fixed it.
Well, he was kind of useful in this movie, though. Of course, that's because his role was originally Spock.
Yeah, barely useful.
Well, he did come up with the theory that using the deflector dish to simulate a photon torpedo would open a gap up in the space wave, and they could fly out.
Yeah, that was some pretty high-level thinking for Scotty.
Again, it was supposed to be Spock.
Yeah. Whatever. Scotty becomes useful in TNG, too. He figures it out. All right, what do we use the shields, buddy? And the fucking hold the doors open so the Enterprise can get out. And then they can just beam us aboard before it crushes us. Because I wouldn't
did
have
a turn into a pirate?
Yeah, he did. He turned into a pirate. He turned into a pirate when he spent fucking 80 years in a goddamn transporter. Okay. Darn, matey.
All right.
I don't know where the pirate accent came from. I really don't. Like, my shitty Scottish accent morphed into a pirate accent, and I don't know why. And I'm going to be honest, I'm a little freaked out.
Yeah, you might seek help for that.
I might need to.
Wow.
So I'm on the fence on the Data Emotion Chip Comedy Hour.
Oh, well, get off the fence. Get off the fence.
Okay.
Like, just pick a side.
Which side?
No, I don't want him to be on the fence on this. I need him to pick a hard side. Like, what are you for or against Data having emotions?
I'm for Data having emotions. I am against the way they portrayed him experiencing his first emotions. They made him into the comic relief of the movie. And I think that really... I think that was detrimental to his experience of having emotions for the first time.
Well, that wasn't the first time he had emotions.
Yeah, because didn't he have the chip put in?
No. Lore was baiting him with it, but he was also sending out some sort of positronic ray wave thing that fucking gave Data emotions. Do you not remember him enjoying choking the shit, just going full BDSM? On the Borg?
God, what is your deal with BDSM right now?
I don't remember that. And he had said that
Rob,
this is the first time.
I want to put you in a gimp suit and just have you in the corner. And every once in a while, like, we'll unzip the mask and be like, all right, say something. And try not to fuck it up. And then inevitably you'd fuck it up when we zip the mask back up.
That went to a weird, dark place.
Yeah.
You two. Like, weirder than my pirate accent.
You two really need to... really need to reflect and gain some perspective on your lives because I think something's gone wrong somewhere. Maybe your diet habits have changed, or
you have no idea. You have no idea, sir.
But no, I don't remember him. I don't remember him doing that. And in the movie, he said, this is the first time that, you know, I've experienced emotion. So I'm kind of,
do you not remember? It was the Hugh episode it was the two-parter where it was Data.
I remember that those
or
episodes.
It was Lore, yeah. And that's when he choked a shit and he was like, got scared because he's like, oh my God, I like this. Like, I enjoyed killing this Borg.
Yeah, I don't remember that part.
Yeah.
So they're being inconsistent with the character too. Yeah, I just don't like the way they wrote him having emotions in this movie. I'm all for Data having emotions. I thought that it worked well in some of the later movies. I just I didn't like it in this one.
Yeah, it was a little grating.
I thought so. At the time, I thought it worked because I was just so excited that he finally had emotions.
Now, I did like that they brought back like the first they did a callback to the first episode.
Yeah, where he was like, the far count. Yeah, the far point count. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think I just was really excited, like back in 94, 95 when this came out, that he had emotions. Like, finally, Jesus. But yeah, it's probably a little grating. As I sat there, the torpedo scene was really hard to watch. Blindy McBlindkins, God, what's his name? LaForge. Or unless you're, McDowell, and then it's LaForge.
I don't know. I like Blindy McBlindkins.
I do too. With the scene with them, like fiddling around with the fucking torpedo. At first, it was kind of funny where he was talking to Mr. Tricorder. And then when things started to go wrong and he was just laughing like a fucking hyena, I'm like, Jesus, just fucking shut him off and beam him back. What the fuck is going on? No, here?
They couldn't beam. There was that dampening field. But was there some CGI involved with his face?
Yeah, they did some
getting stretching out or whatever.
Face morphing or some
they shot morphing. They spent the budget for the champagne scene on his face.
Okay.
Yeah.
Perfect. Hey, so how come seatbelts aren't needed in spaceships?
Jesus fucking Christ. Star Trek has a seatbelt fucking problem. Yeah.
God,
I mean, that is one thing. So that is one thing that I like about the new Star Trek, the Kelvin timeline, that they have those restraints.
Straps
or something. Yeah. Perfect. Great. You know this is going to happen. You're going to get in trouble. Let's not protect our dudes. Let's let them just fly around the ship.
I really wanted to see Riker go. And I like Riker, but I really wanted to see him just take a header through the fucking view screen.
When he was on that sliding captain's chair.
Yeah, and it just stopped and he just went fucking head first, flying like goddamn Superman. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, and I like Riker, but I was like, fuck it. I mean, if we're going to go full dumb here, let's just like full left-handed. Like, let's just have him fly through the view screen for fuck's sake. It's just stupid. Yeah.
I do like that they actually started using actual spherical shockwaves.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. 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 Showing. Well. Yeah. I guess it was spherical. Yeah.
You were questioning that. You know what a sphere is, right? It's like a three-dimensional circle.
Right. Yeah. But then I was also thinking about. I was thinking about the ribbon. I was like, well, the ribbon wasn't spherical. But then I was like, oh yeah, that's just a.
Yeah, that's a ribbon. It's an energy ribbon, not a fucking...
Yeah, a little anomaly thing. Mm-hmm. Which, how does it... I guess it's on this big, giant, like, loop orbit around the universe? Because it comes through the area every 39 years?
Yeah,
well, that wouldn't be the whole universe. Rob, how big do you think the universe is?
But 39 years. It's got to be bigger than 39 years worth.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Did they say it fucking orbited the universe?
Yeah, it says it passes through this sector every 39 years, which means
that's the galaxy, not the universe.
Okay, universe, galaxy, but still 39 years. That's
it's traveling pretty fucking fast.
What's it going? What's it circling? The God planet,
giant black hole at the fucking middle of the galaxy because we destroyed God because he wanted a starship and we were like, fuck no.
Oh, that's right.
He imploded into himself into a black hole because when TNG comes around, that's what it is. A giant black hole in the middle of the galaxy because they're like, Star Trek V is kind of left-handed. We're not going to fucking, let's just not talk about it.
Yeah. So the distances and the speeds and the times that they had in this movie were very, very inconsistent and very, very off. So,
like the 11 second probe?
Yeah, so like the probe that went from the planet to the sun in 11 seconds. Would have been flying faster than the speed of light.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I think it would have a better launch mechanism than what it had.
And the 2 seconds that the Enterprise had to blow a hole in Lursa and Bajor's
No. It's 2 Riker seconds.
Riker seconds, which is like
he's got
fucking forever.
He's got to get up and he's got a pose.
Yeah, he's got a mug for the camera.
Yeah. And then say fire.
No, he didn't say it like that.
Oh, sorry. My bad.
How do you say
fire?
There you go.
Like that.
There you go.
Yeah, it was like with conviction. Like he was pissed. Like he wanted that photon torpedo to do things to fucking Lursa and Betor.
Yeah, and he said what? Target their power or something.
Well, he didn't say don't blow it up.
Yeah.
Because they blew it the fuck up.
They blew it. One torpedo. Yeah.
Well, it was tiny ship. It's a 20-year-old bird of prey is what they said. So it's out of commission. So, like it's done its thing. Right. It's a small.
Yeah, yeah.
And we know that birds of prey only do about 13, 14 fucking crew. So.
Yeah. So those ships are tiny. I mean, they were tiny compared to the Constitution class. Compared to a Galaxy class. I mean, they're like a shuttle almost.
Yeah.
But birds get away of prey seem to be able to fuck up Enterprise ships pretty easily.
Yeah. Well, you know, when you have a mole in the system and you can get past their shields, apparently after shields, the plating is paper thin.
So Kirk's the horse that Kirk was riding was a beautiful horse. I enjoyed the Kirk scenes. I really enjoyed the Kirk scenes. This felt like a fucking TNG episode, except for most of the scenes with Kirk. So it started out like a Star Trek movie. And then it switched over to the TNG side, and it felt like a TNG episode. And then when they went back to the Nexus, it kind of felt like a movie again.
This is the only one of the movies that I felt actually played like a movie. Now, that doesn't mean I wasn't insanely disappointed with it when it came out. And upon reflection, some 25 years later, it's really not that bad. I think I was disappointed at the time because there was no, I wanted more interaction between both crews.
Right. Yeah, they kind of hyped it. If I remember correctly, they kind of hyped it up that, oh, it's two crews in the same movie.
Yeah. Well, it was.
Both captains are going to fight side by side, you know.
And we got 10 minutes of Kirk being Kirk. And it didn't even make sense. It was basically three geriatric fucks trying to fight. That's all it was. It was like a fucking free-for-all brawl at the fucking tapioca night in the cafeteria at the old folks' home. It was fucking dumb. It was just silly because Kirk is the fighter. And I guess that makes a little bit of sense, but he's 110 at this point. Fucking Malcolm McDowell's a fucking 110, and fucking Sir Patrick Stewart. Like, he's not the fighting type. That's not the captain he was. Right. He wasn't the Russian headstrong. He was the, I'm going to outthink you and outmaneuver you because I'm smarter than you, which is why I like him a lot. Kirk's the derp derp. I'll go up here with my fist, boop a boop in your face, and I'll win, then I'll fuck your wife, whoop a doop a doop.
Where's the rock? I need to hit you on the head with the rock.
Right. It was just, oh, God. I hated that whole scene. I thought Picard going down there, it was going to be a little bit different. And it wasn't. I wanted more. I really, really, really just wanted more of like the handoff, right? Like, we didn't get a handoff for the series because the series were so far apart. And I get the movies were kind of far apart too, but.
Well, they really weren't.
But they weren't, right?
Like, it was the last seven years. No, it was 3 years before this that Undiscovered Country came out. Undiscovered Country was 91.
Then that's even worse. Like, it should have been, there should have been a handoff and there should have been a story that brought the crew of the original Enterprise into the future.
They tried.
I would have been okay with some.
They tried. They couldn't make it plausible. They couldn't make it believable.
Then fuck. Look, if Sulu was that big of a, I am a star and I am the captain and the captain. Fine. Fuck it. Right around that. Fucking Sulu died. Here's his daughter. Except get somebody who's a little bit hotter. Cause that I was all right with. That would have been fine. I would have been like, cool. Sulu's daughter's hot.
So that's your criteria for replacing characters that the replacement is hot.
Fuck yeah, yes. Because, that should be the criteria for every movie. Well, you're going to replace Tony Stark in the MCU, fucking replace him with a hot chick.
And okay,
Tanya Stark.
The age that she was, he had to have had her before he became captain.
Right.
Which they were always together. You know, so he never had a family.
So are you saying that she is the secret love child of Sulu and Kirk?
I'm not saying that. You're saying that, and I'm okay with that.
All right. Can we talk for just a second how Deanna Troi is such a smoke show?
Yes. Yes, we can.
And fucking Dr. Crusher. She was a smoke show, too.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I forgot how hot they were.
I wasn't as wild about Gates McFadden as I was Marina Sirtis. Look,
man, then you've never, like, have you not dated a redhead? Did you never date a redhead in the day? Well, then you should know. Like, if you know, you know.
I guess I don't know that holds true for every redhead.
Well, look in McFadden's eyes and tell me that doesn't hold true. Oh, it absolutely does.
This got awkward.
Just now? This whole fucking episode's been awkward.
Yeah. So I got two other things. How does I don't understand the time travel in this thing.
Yeah, nobody does.
How the hell do you go back to a planet that the ribbon hasn't even touched yet and just warp back?
Well, what happened to the Picard that was already there and hadn't been swallowed up by the ribbon yet?
Maybe it's his brain. This whole thing's an alternate timeline, and it's all kinds of fucked up because they're all wearing different uniforms throughout the whole fucking movie.
Yeah, but there's a reason for that. But
I'm wearing a DS9 episode.
Yep.
Uniform.
So I posted,
I'm wearing a fucking Voyager uniform. This guy's wearing a TNG uniform. Like, nobody knows what the fuck's going on.
So I posted a picture in our channel there that there's a picture of what they wanted the uniforms to be.
Right.
They ran out of time, or they didn't work.
No, the director nixed it.
Oh, yeah, that's what it was. The director didn't like them, but they wanted, was it the producers or the Paramount wanted new uniforms?
So basically the movie. The director decided to start transitioning the crew over to the DS9 and Voyager uniforms. So
it should be a hard look. I've never been in the military, so I don't know. But I would imagine that when the military wants to roll out new uniforms, they just roll out the fucking new uniforms. It's not like a slow transition where, okay, guys.
No, there's a transition.
Casual Friday. It's wear your old uniform day.
There's typically a transition. There's just too many people to roll it all out at once.
On a ship of 1,000 people?
Well, but I mean, you figure Starfleet's doing this across Starfleet, so.
Right, but all have replicators.
It's a replicators. Yeah.
Well, I know, but putting the replicators aside, I don't know.
Well, you can't.
Eventually, all the crew members went over.
Make everything.
Eventually,
3D print the shit.
Eventually, all the crew members went over to the DS9 style turtleneck.
Yeah, and they look like they're uncomfortable and hot as fuck.
Well, so
a bunch of wool.
Riker and Geordi's DS9 uniforms weren't even theirs. They weren't made for them. So
no, they were made for
So Geordi
Garrett
was
Wang.
Chief O'Brien.
O'Brien.
Yeah, O'Brien.
So he was using O'Brien's uniform, and Riker was using Sisko's uniform. And Sisko's uniform didn't quite fit him, so he had to roll up the sleeves, which looks stupid. I couldn't stand. I was like, what the fuck is wrong with his sleeves? Why are they so short? Oh, it looked like shit.
Yeah. Like, this was, again, it's a Star Trek movie that was hastily thrown together.
Yes.
And it suffered because of it. It's still fun. I still think it's one of the better ones. There's a lot of nostalgia that goes along with it, but it's not bad.
It's middle of the pack for me.
Yeah. I'm okay with that. Yeah. Let me ask you a Star Trek question real quick. Mm-hmm. Which engineer would you want? Would you want Scotty? Would you want... And not Spock. All right, you got to pick either Scotty.
No, I want Spock.
No, you can't have him.
He's Scotty, a science officer. He's not an engineer.
As McDowell says, Le Forge. As he whispers it creepily in his ear, Le Forge.
So I would take Le Forge if I had the choice between Le Forge and Scotty.
No.
But I
there's more.
Oh, there's more.
There's okay. O'Brien. Would you rather have Chief O'Brien? Or would you rather have B'Elanna?
I'd want B'Elanna.
Yeah, Alana's fucking hot.
Yeah.
I would take O'Brien because I don't. Balana can't either, fix shit, which she's just fun to look at. So I'd take Chief O'Brien. He can fix anything.
Nah, I think LaForge is a better engineer than O'Brien.
And if there's a problem with the transporter, you call O'Brien too.
And he fixes it. Yeah.
Where, like, if you're Scotty, you gotta be like, also, hey, Spock, hey, matey, I need you to come down and fix the transporters.
And O'Brien also, you know, he was good at tactical at one point. He flew the ship at one point.
O'Brien. Holy shit. Like he has a background in just fucking killing Cardassians. That was the backstory on him during the Cardassian War. He was like a fucking butcher. So good on him. I'm even more in fucking O'Brien's camp now. What's B'Elanna going to do? Fall in love with the dopey helmsman and have a baby? Dumb.
So I'm still of the opinion that you do not let Deanna drive.
She's not very good.
No.
It's not only in this movie. I think there's another movie that she fucks up a ship driving too.
Wouldn't it make more sense for Data to drive?
Well, he was driving at the end when they were crashing on the planet. Yeah, he was like, I got to get the thrusters going so we don't just plow face first.
Yeah, but why didn't they just have him drive the first time?
So you guys want a quick and fun Deanna Troi story? I may have said this before on the show.
Well, let's hear it.
Okay. So apparently the actress who plays Deanna Troi.
Rena Sirtis.
Marina Sirtis. She was in, let's just say, like a Skinamax. It's not an X-rated movie. It's more of a Y-rated movie, maybe. I don't know. Whatever they fucking call it. Like soft porn.
Okay.
At a Trek convention back in the mid-90s, somebody had a copy of this movie. And they were in line for the meet and greet and get the autograph and they handed her the movie that she is topless in and doing, you know, some things that you probably would never see her do again. And she got very, very, very upset and made a scene and like threw the movie and kicked the guy out. It was hilarious is what it was. Yeah. So there's your Marina Sirtis story. Super hot, but man. Don't let her know you've seen her tits because she does not like that. Or maybe she just doesn't like to sign the movie. I don't know.
I don't know. I mean, I guess being in her shoes, I might feel the same way.
I don't know if my Wang's out there and somebody's like, hey, man, I really like your Wang. Can you sign this for me? Sure. Fuck it. I don't care. Enjoy my Wang.
Rob, would you look through your archives and...
Would you like an autographed copy of my Wang?
No. Or, whoa, wait. I thought I was looking for Marina Sirtis.
I don't care you're looking for. Both might be out there.
I want the Wang pictures. I want to get that signed.
I knew what Jason wanted. Harry Wang?
What?
You want Harry Wang? Garrett Wang? I'm sorry. Garrett Wang?
Did you say Harry Jesus Wang? Christ.
Harry Kim. Did you yeah, say I, Harry I, Wang? I went two different
that's
ways
a
there.
Freudian slip again. No.
Because he played
the highest level.
Garrett yeah, Wang no, plays Harry Wang, Kim.
Dude, I got you.
Yeah. So the seventh movie you want to watch is Thor.
Oh God damn it!
It's too late, Harry Wang.
So apparently given to his own devices, Picard will get Bizet. Do you see how many fucking children he had?
Well, it's because he time traveled. And back then, to the time that he traveled to, you had to have a lot of children because they didn't live to be very old.
Wait, what?
Because,
Are you talking about?
Because when he went into the Nexus and all that kind of fun stuff, the house that he was in was all like 18th century English.
So Victorian style, yeah. They still have Victorian style now. I'm sure they'll have Victorian style in the future.
No. I like to think that he went back that far because that was his happy place.
So his chateau in Picard was still in the style, in the chateau style of France from way back then.
Not near as heavy. Not near as heavy.
What are you talking about?
It wasn't as heavy handed.
They moved it. That house in Picard was originally built in France and they moved it fucking years and years ago to California.
No, I'm saying it. Yeah, well, the set dressing wasn't near as heavy-handed as it was in this. I mean,
neither
they were wearing...
is his accent. His accent is fucking English.
Well, yeah. Like, I am going to take my bottle, and I'm just doing this.
Going to look for Harry Wang. I just threw
a bottle in the trash, and it didn't explode.
You're not in space.
I got a question for you, Crowley.
Do you like Harry Wang?
I love Harry Wang. Do you like Harry Wang? Harry Wang, Harry Wang.
Oh, shit. Crowley, question. Yes,
sir. Yeah.
Is Star Trek Generations more sci-fi than 11-22-63?
Time travel in this, and it's done about as haphazardly as it was in 11-22-63. But what saves this movie is there's some photon torpedoes, some starships, some lasers, and some really fast moving fucking missiles. Star Trek Generations, more sci-fi than 11-22-63, or whatever Harry Wang fucking Rob's trying to find.
Hey, Rob.
Is your haiku called Ode to Harry Wang?
No, it's called Fuck You Crowley Part 17.
Rob, you got a haiku for us this week?
I do. This one is titled Data's Fetish. There is, yeah. All right, so Data's Fetish. Life forms, where are you? You precious little life forms. Oh, shit, I'm scared now.
That's kind of funny, but not really as funny as Harry Wang.
It would have been funnier if you didn't have Harry Wang on your mind.
Rob, sometimes the podcast gold that you shit out, I'm amazed by it. But we hand you a nugget of gold, you like to throw it over your shoulder because later on you're going to just shit something out that's so much better.
And then I'm going to smear it all over the bathroom stall.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
All right, Matthew, I'm looking for that Harry Wang.
Oh, wait. Wait, was that Scottish or was that pirate?
I don't know.
That was Pirate Scotty. It's
Pirate Scotty looking for Harry Wang. I hear he's a miracle worker too, Arr.
Arr.
No one else is going to be laughing at this but us. Everyone else listening to this is going, what the fuck are these idiots on?
Oh, goddamn. All right. Any final thoughts?
No.
Everybody Harry Wang Chung tonight. I don't know. I got nothing. That's it. In the fucking show.
Yeah. I don't think we can top Harry Wang.
No, there's no topping that. I thought we couldn't top the whole cock slip a couple of episodes ago from Rob, but he has outdone himself with the Harry Wang Freudian slip.
All right. Well, next week we are going to continue getting sauced as we review Star Trek First Contact. This is the movie where the Borg travel back in time intent on preventing Earth's first contact with an alien species. Captain Picard and his crew pursue them to ensure that Zefram Cochran makes his maiden flight reaching warp speed. This one is directed by your boy Frakes and stars all the TNG regulars. Next week, Summer of Star Trek continues. with First Contact. I think this is probably a better movie than this one.
I hated this movie.
Did you really?
Yep. I didn't like how they portrayed Zefram Cochrane. And if you've seen the original series where they run into Zefram Cochrane, you'll understand why. He was basically a Boy Scout. I didn't like the whole, is this the one where they're, yeah, First Contact. Yeah, I didn't like that. I didn't like the whole time travel thing. I'm so sick of fucking time travel, and I was sick of it then. I'm sick of it now as some kind of fucking story crutch. And I didn't like the character that was played by, what's her name? The one that Picard was fucking ferrying around, and then she was calling him on his fucking genocidal bullshit against the Borg.
I can't remember her name either.
I thought that character was fucking shallow as shit. I thought, look, the Borg are invaders.
Save it for next week.
Well, there you go. I fucking hate this movie.
That's got it for this week. Our intro and outro music is Welcome Home by Cam Bopod. Crawl music is Snack Mix by Machette. If you like the show, please rate and review us on iTunes. You can leave us feedback on our Discord channel at smokinganddrinkinginspace.com/Discord, on Twitter at @SatisunderscorePodcast, or you can email us at smokinganddrinkinginspace@outlook.com. If you'd like to throw a few nickels our way, you can become a Patreon supporter by going to smokinganddrinkinginspace.com/Patreon. For this week, I'm Jason.
Harry Wang tier. Can we? I couldn't wait until he got done. I want a Harry Wang tier for the Patreon.
I don't know.
However, I am going to go ahead and watch Blind Date. That's the porno that Marina Sirtis was in.
Are you putting it in the channel right now?
I don't know what you're talking about.
I will talk to you next week.
Yeah, I did. Hey, Mr. Spaceman. Time traveling spaceman, who are you?